To draw now. You should have a card if you haven't sawn it in half. We'd like you to draw the world's first novelty teapot.
Alan. Sorry. It's quite a draft in here, it turns out. Yeah.
What did I ask you to draw?
Draw the world's first novelty teapot.
Dan, you were listening. That's very good.
It's gone out that side. But yeah. When you asked me, it was still in the middle.
All right, so get drawing.
The world's first. You mean we're inventing one? Or there is one that we should know about.
This is nice. I like it when the class get on with their business. Busy and quiet.
The teacher sits at the front just texting her friend.
Do you know that rhyme? I'm a little teapot, short and stout. Here's my handle. Oh, bugger, I'm a sugar bowl. How are you doing? Is everyone ready to show yet? Yes, David, you look as if you've finished.
Yeah, I have finished. I'm very pleased with it.
Is it an Indian goddess or a crab?
It's a novelty teapot.
Oh, yes, sorry.
I was distracted, but I thought they have a lot of tea in India, and their vague goddess is a bit like that. And one thing, the best bit, the sort of business end of a teapot, is the spout. So someone might have invented one with lots of spouts.
A multiple-spouted teapot.
You have to pretty much surround it with... and that's that thing on the front that looks like an ear, which is not an ear. That's the sort of
the
handle.
Does it come with a cream to treat scalding and burns?
No, but it came in a society in which the burning of various members of it was not considered important by those in charge.
Good point. Good satirical point. Yeah. What have you got then, Rob?
What I've done is I've come up with a thing called handy tea. Oh. So it's a teapot. This actually, all jokes aside, this could be a goer. This. The finger is cocking a snook to authority, so that'll appeal to the youngsters. But the rest of it, and I've called it handy tea.
Yes.
Which finger exactly?
That's a thumb.
It's a weird...
No. You're absolutely...
Yeah, it's a very weird...
Long, unless it's the left hand...
Which has got five fingers.
You're absolutely right, yes. It's not anatomically correct.
No, that's
a... It's only a prototype.
Anatomically, contents may differ upon delivery. Anyway, but I think you'd have to agree there's something for everyone in
that. I think it's very wise of you to have signed it.
Yes, I have.
If you hadn't, I would have nicked that idea. No. I'd probably leave the recording at this point in order to capitalise on it.
Dara, what have you got?
It's supposed to be an Egyptian character.
Oh, yes.
See, I thought you wanted the first one. I want some historical. And the Egyptian character is doing the traditional Egyptian hieroglyphic thing, but that it pours out of the arm.
Ah. That's very clever.
Now, fortunately, I don't know. I can't draw Egyptian clothes, so I've made him wear a small tuxedo. And a little dicky bow. So he's an Egyptian on the way to some sort of black tie event, maybe the opening of a pyramid.
And you've not only signed it, you've actually put a copyright notice on it.
Just in case that isn't the correct answer. No. I think it's actually...
Superb.
I just say to David, I've also now copyrighted
it. Ah, very good. Well done. You have to put the date if you copyright something.
Shh. Yes.
Do you think I should copyright mine?
Save the ink.
Yeah. Alan, what have you?
No, what I've done is I've done a bloke with a beak, and he's. It's a long, tall pot.
Oh, yes.
You can feel the feet as well. It'll stand there. That's his arm, and then it'll all come out of his.
That works.
His feet, and then his little baseball cap. That's the lid. The only drawback here is you will need long, thin tea bags.
I think that's going to be a hell of a difficult thing to clean.
But you shouldn't clean a teapot.
Don't clean a teapot.
You don't clean a teapot,
you should never
David.
Clean a teapot.
No.
Under no circumstance.
If it's being used as a teapot...
I have only...
I sense a hypothetical situation.
This is not a hypothetical situation. I've only ever used a teapot for tea. But occasionally, if you make sort of tea in a teapot once in a blue moon when you can be bothered in a vague attempt to seem more civilised than you actually are, you then sort of leave, still got a bit of tea in
it,
some
tea.
Oh, yeah, you rinse it out.
No, you don't rinse it out because you forget, because immediately you're tired of being civilised and you want to go to the pub. You leave it for weeks and weeks and months and months, and then when you have a look in it, it's gone disgustingly mouldy.
And it's talking to you.
Yeah. At that point, the flavour that you would get if you didn't wash it from your next cup of tea is, if anything, too characteristic.
There is an animal that uses the golden spiral shape to capture its prey.
Big cats.
No, if I
the
use
looping the, run to avoid.
If I use the word gyre, will that help? Turning and turning and the widening gyre.
Otters.
Does that mean anything to you?
Otters.
The falcon cannot hear the falconer.
Is it a cow?
Things fall apart. The centre cannot hold.
Stephen.
Yeah.
Is it a cow? Heard, sorry.
No.
Some sort of a hunting.
The falconer.
Is it a falcon?
The mouse!
You are bad. Yes, a falcon. A gyre falcon. It uses that shape too because it has this very strong centre part. It allows it to keep its head still. And
I thought a falcon does that.
I thought
yeah, no, talk about its eyes. The way it flies around in a circle.
I thought you said about the falcon and the mouse because the barley can't hear.
Say again?
Well, the mouse hunts the barley, doesn't he?
The mouse hunts the barley.
Well, mice eat barley.
Oh, I see, yes.
You were talking about the falcon.
Oh, yes.
And what can't hear. And the mouse can hear the falcon, but the barley can't hear the mouse.
No. Yeah.
So, the mouse could approach the barley straight off, but he doesn't. Yeah. He mimics his hunter.
Yeah. In a way, if the barley could hear the mouse, there's not much he could do about it.
I'm almost certain that at some point the alarm clock's going to go off and I'm going to go, God, that was a weird nightmare.
But medical science moves on, barley will develop legs, obviously. And the mice has had the foresightedness to learn to hunt his prey should, you know, the GM crops develop further than the mouse's capabilities.
So is that what mice say to each other? They say, thank God, when the barley develops legs, that it's death.
Of course it does!
It doesn't benefit the barley to not be eaten.
No.
It needs to be
eaten. Barley wants to be eaten.
There's certain... That's why the fruit hangs on the tree and glows brightly and wants to be eaten.
Yeah.
I've always looked at barley and gone, tart.
So maybe barley has got legs, but just doesn't use them.
Just hides them underground.
Yeah, maybe barley stalks mice.
You mean barley's a slut?
Right. Now, if everyone could roll their tongues for me. Very good. And go close up on Graham. What the hell?
I think it's supposed to be an illustration of a child of two geniuses may not necessarily be a genius.
I don't know who says that. Yes, rolling tongues, where does that gift come from?
A fish.
I do.
You asked.
Yes, I did. And you gave an answer. You avoided the trap, which was to say from your parents that it's genetically handed down, and it's not. It's one of these things that some people can do and some people can't. And it isn't related to the fact that if you come to parents who can do it, you will therefore be able to do it. And there are other things that some people can do and some people can't, like asparagus and urine. Does it make your urine smell?
It makes everyone's urine smell.
No, it doesn't.
Maybe not ladies.
Yeah, mostly women don't have the problem. I mean, can you put your hand up if you've never noticed an effect of asparagus in the smell of your urine?
Weird.
You've never noticed that.
Yes, some people don't, you see, and that's quite a lot of
people. You've hardly finished chewing.
I know. It's always...
And then you're peeing and it stinks.
They used to call it...
Diners are pointing at you.
They used to call it housemaid's despair because the next morning, if someone had asparagus, the housemaid would take down the chamber pot. Like, ow!
I just want to say, I find, maybe I'm wrong, maybe yeah, this is. Yeah. I find the smell of urine quite distasteful anyway.
But there's no. Believe me.
If you've got stinky pee, you need to see someone.
I don't.
There's something wrong with you.
No, wait.
Disease.
I don't think it. I don't think
your pee presumably weird. Doesn't make you go. Bleh.
I don't think
it makes me go. I'll not drink that.
Yes, I mean, if you peed out Chardonnay, I mean that would be something else.
Best to leave that alone.
Yeah,
I feel. Yeah, now, I don't, yeah.
Seriously, I leave it alone because I've just done it into a toilet.
Yeah, okay. I didn't think that I was. You know, I was flavouring.
If you decanted it, if you decanted it, but it would be different.
When I was a child, sugar puffs made it smell of sugar puffs to me.
Anybody else?
Yeah. Oh, good. Yeah. So nice
I'm
not to feel alone, isn't it?
People are a lot more interested in their wee than they'll admit.
That's certainly true.
I think people say, what are you interested
people
in?
People are interested in what comes out of them. I think there's a general rule. Yeah. Not in a kind of a icky way, but there is an element of...
It's you.
That.
I just wanted to make the point where you ask someone about their interests, they'll say, you know, walking, cinema, books. They won't say, well, primarily,
you're
you know,
right.
The smell of my own farts, I'm always fascinated by. But, you know, they don't come all the time, so I while away the rest of the time with cinema, books and long... If I could just fart all day and smell it, I would be a fascinated man.
You're so right. And I think most psychologists would agree with you and say it is true, but it's an unspoken
ask
truth.
Ask to anyone on Earth, when they've just farted and smelt it, who is bored.
When you see someone reading, and they're reading a book, and they're reading a book, and if they go like that... they're not thinking about the book, they just let one go.
Now, why don't we have more women as guests on QI? You may well ask.
Oh, I know this. No.
Oh, no, no, no. Is
that so female? No, no, up to you. Is it because women are just not funny? Yeah.
No, that's right. But we're good at other things. We're good at raising kittens and knitting cakes.
Yeah. I've heard this a lot. I've heard that women aren't funny, and I think there's a truth in this. I think that there is a scientific, possibly, relationship between a sense of humour and the male sex organ.
People are always laughing at mine.
Yeah, well, there you are.
Is this to do with the fact that people always say there aren't as many female comedians as there are men? Because you know what? There are loads of female comedians. It's just that we just don't see them because they're systematically rounded up and kept in a pen just outside Harwich.
Harwich?
Yes, Harwich. But you can go and see them and you can adopt them online. Yeah. And you can go and you can visit them and you can feed them lines and you might get a joke back sometimes. Oh. And then sometimes some of them escape and they disguise themselves as male comedians. But you can always tell which ones the male comedians are, the ones with the beards. Just like Life of Brian.
Bill Bailey.
Bill Bailey.
Clearly a woman.
But, you know, it's really rare to be allowed to sit next to a female comedian. I don't know what they're worried that our cycles will suddenly synchronise or something.
I'm not. I'm in disguise. I'm Rory Bremner. I'm doing...
Hello. Is it because once you get them started, they don't shut up?
But here's a good gag. What sort of person wears one of these?
Lord.
You can try it on yourself if you like.
Oh, this is a good idea.
It's got little... Ooh.
Oh, sound of polystyrene.
Yeah, I know. There you are. Sorry, it is, isn't it? It's something.
Oh, this is a tongue thing.
Yeah.
It stops your lady talking. I can't remember what they're called.
That's it.
Does the word pony boy come in this answer? I don't know.
Pony boy?
Yes.
Excuse me. That's it. Oh, I say, it fits you rather well.
Oh, and it's got
it
stuck.
It sounded like you're having an idea then. Quite disconcerting.
Giddy up.
No, you're very. You've given me a thought there, Alan. I was scrubbed and brought to my room.
Actually, don't bother to have him scrub. did they call anybody know?
A quick kringle.
So close.
A quick kringle.
What's the answer, Alan? Let's do the letters. One for yes. Is it A?
Is it a device used for pigs when they're constipated? I'm pretty sure that's one of those, isn't it?
Sorry, Alan, I probably should have said before. What they do is they strap it on and ram it home.
So it's a sort of chastity belt for the face.
It's known as a Scold's bridle.
Scold's bridle.
Oh, that's it.
Oh, so it's just being ducked in the
ideally,
river.
Ideally, though, you've got to get
like
it before he says it.
Yeah. Punishment for being a scold, you're ducked in the water.
The other punishment, the more common punishment, was what's called a cucking stool, which is often called a ducking stool. Quite wrongly, it is actually a cucking stool. But anyway,
excuse me, it's that's the wrong word. It's not. Get me off the cucking stool.
Bouncy castles, they're the best. I hired one for my son's fifth birthday. Oh, what? Anyway, all
really
the kids
fun?
Are gone. Oh, yeah. Oh, here we go.
What do you do? You just.
You just fling bounce. Yourself about. It's brilliant. And actually, when they set the fancy castle up, they set it up for me and they handed me the safety instructions. And I was trying to read the safety instructions. All these kids bouncing around in the. And within 2 minutes, one kid got mullered in the face. He's bleeding. And about a few hours later, some parents came to pick the kids up, and the safety instructions for the bouncy castle were on the table with blood on it. Fine.
Presumably, like those slides on aeroplanes in emergencies, they tell people to take off their high heels.
Yes.
Imagine would it be an important
first step.
Yes. Obviously, yes.
I always used to get nosebleeds on them, and someone would always wee on those things. They get incredibly excited, the young kids.
Oh, yeah.
And there's always a wet patch, as if a puppy has been on there.
I'm just the wrong generation. They didn't exist when I was a child.
Really?
No, we had to make do with pigs and
big fat men.
Big fat men?
Hey!
Oh, I see.
Hey!
Dancing on the tummy.
You remember?
Uncle's tummy.
Come on.
At the country fete.
Come on, kids.
Come on. We're going up the sumo park. Oh. Come on.
Someone's weed on me.
Yes. The vicar has volunteered again. But it's.
Come on, vicar.
I've always seen the thing about Parmesan. You know when you buy Parmesan, I've never understood why it has a sell-by date on it. Because it just never goes off, does it? You could put it on a rooftop in Nairobi for a year. It just well, nothing. Why do they have to have a sell-by date?
So that you will destroy it and buy some more. You buy cheese at the supermarket and it says consume within 2 days of opening or something.
Yes.
And it's a cheese that's a vast amount of... How much cheese do you think I'm going to get through? Yeah. Why? It's fine.
Yeah.
They know it's fine.
Plus it has a label on it saying 20 years aged.
You've sold 2 days before it's completely inedible.
It is true.
It's gone off already. I mean, cheese, basically, hasn't it?
Well, that's its point, exactly. Yeah. It is the celebration of what happens when milk goes off big-time styly.
Yeah. It should just... I think you should work for the milk marketing board. Get some lovely English milk gone off big-time styly. I'll have a milk gone off from Big Time Styley and tomato sandwich. That's a brilliant description. That's the best description of cheese I've ever heard.
But also, aren't those sell-by dates are just overcautious, aren't they? You could probably leave it.
Yeah, they're just
for
covering
ages.
Themselves in case you get ill.
Get it out the bin a couple of weeks later.
Put it down your pants, go in the sauna.
Sean,
take it out.
Sean, you
obviously reshape it again.
Sean, you're not alone. There are people here.
You're saying it out loud. Yes. You're not thinking it.
We had a tortoise once, and it had a very, very bad arthritis in its leg. And they said, we can actually operate and replace it with a wheel.
They do that, don't they?
Yeah. Yeah.
Actually, casters, so they can go in all directions.
Oh, did you do that?
We thought about taking all his legs off and just putting wheels on all of them.
Yeah, that would have been wrong.
And then a little engine on the aerial. Sending down a shop.
An aerial on a spring.
Well, you can cut a jar that's some peanuts on it. You can't. I bet you couldn't do that. Did I bet you someone would object if you motorised a tortoise.
Really? The RSPCA first.
Oh, because you can have lorries like... Corona's gone mad, don't
you? Can't even mutilate a tortoise anymore.
What's suggesting you mutilate it?
You know who would get... had a tortoise?
Vegetarian.
It could keep its legs. It could keep its legs. I'm thinking of some slight... like a Bigfoot truck in America. Oh, yeah. Big wheels that could be detached so that it could be a tortoise and run around and eat weeds. And then...
his legs
and
go
then
up.
You could, when he wanted to go shopping, you could just send it off to the shop.
A transformer tortoise.
Yes. Yeah. And there's great big ones in the Galapagos Islands.
Oh, they're terrific.
They could bring quite big, substantial pieces of furniture back for you.
They could take off.
They could, yeah.
Tortoise's
tongue.
Now, the socks that that man in the middle is wearing are very long socks, and... just out of interest for you, that's something that I've turned to recently. I now favour the longer socks.
Can you take me through your reasoning?
Yes, I can. Well, I'll show you. Yeah. The gentleman's sock.
The half hose. It's called
now,
the half hose.
Now, Joe, you, as a lady, you're going to think this sock is going to stop a lot sooner than it does. So, watch this. Look at that. Surely we've reached the peak.
Oh, my goodness me.
Surely we've peaked. No.
Oh, my word.
Surely.
He's wearing tights. Oh.
Can I say, not so much for Joe, but Stephen, Alan and Sean, I urge you to give it a go. Mm. Because it gives you a feeling of security.
They do make you look like a knobhead. Sorry. Rob.
Well, one of the problems men
they
have...
Do.
There's a problem men have, Joe, but which Steve, is that Steve, we wear away the hair on our shins by tight, short socks, don't we? Is that one of the things you're
afraid of? By just carrying on the conversation, you imply that you agree with what Joe is saying.
What was going through my mind is how difficult it would ever be for a man to say that to a woman, that's all. And I thought, I'm not going to go in that direction. We allow women to be rude to us.
Could you please come down on one side or the other here? Yeah. Of my,
you're either with me or you're with her.
It's true, but it's just as true that women make themselves look positively ridiculous occasionally.
It doesn't make you look cool. Put it that way. Nobody's going to go, I'm going to get a pair of those.
Well, at the risk of turning this into Ready, Steady, Cook, why don't we let the audience decide?
All those who think Rob is really onto something with the gentleman's half hose, as I believe they are technically called, the long sock, the Brighton long sock, could you please shout out, long sock?
Long sock! Oh, it's not good.
That's not good. I fear without having to ask...
There's no need to carry on.
No, OK. Yeah. There's a thing with Pascal's wager, you know, Blaise Pascal, the French mathematician and philosopher. He said, well, all right, well, let's just make a bet, because if there is no God and there is no afterlife, then when you die, that's the end of it, all right. But supposing there is one, and it may be an infinitesimal chance, it may be billions to one that there's an afterlife, but why not bet that there will be one? Because if you're wrong, the same will happen. Nothing.
Yes,
whereas if you're wrong and you bet there isn't a God, then you've got a poker up your bottom for eternity. Which is a real bore.
The nuns told me, he knows what you're thinking.
Yes. That's
it. He knows.
Yes.
So it's already, as soon as you made the bet, you're already so as good as dead.
You are.
But what if there's a third option and there is an afterlife, but you only get to go to it if you were an atheist?
Oh, I love that one. That's an amusing one.
Because then you get all the Christians dead. And then a load of bitter atheists going, and worst of all, I was wrong.
They've got eternity to worry about.
Yeah, exactly, with these lovely angels offering them cream cakes. You're sod off.
What would you use this for? I have a picture of them here.
Oh, it's frightening the children.
It's a German invention.
Put a torch behind it, and then you creep up into their bedroom at night when they're asleep. Well, just move it very slowly across the room.
It's a thing that is used in the lavatory, in the WC. No, it's a habit. It's for men to do something when they go to the lavatory. It's to encourage them...
The seat? Anything to do with the seat?
It is to do with the seat.
To dive off it into the toilet?
No. Noble guess, but doomed. No.
Do they sit down in Germany?
It's if they lift the seat, which men tend to do before having a pee. This, I have one here. Here it is.
Hello, this is your toilet speaking. Wouldn't you rather like to sit down? Oh, you prefer to stand? Well, then you may leave now.
Poor German men don't actually get to go to the toilet then, do they? No wonder they're wearing that lederhosen and slapping themselves all the time.
No, the point is, in Germany, they think it's somehow unhygienic because of splashing and things. They want the men to sit. Mm. So it's like, that's how it's attached. So when you lift up the seat, it starts speaking at you loud enough in a public lavatory for others to hear so that men sit and have a pee. That's
well,
the idea.
Well, splashing is a problem. We've got builders in at the moment, and they're all using the lower loo. It is like the Centre Park's log flume in there.
Is that why you've got the long socks?
Do you know there's this thing that when you write an email at a certain time, it makes you solve a mathematical puzzle before it will send it. So that you kind of go, you! Or, you know, I've always wanted to sleep with you or something, you've sent to, you know, the Prime Minister or whatever. And then you press send, they go, I have to do that. And you think, oh, God. And by the time you've done it, you think, oh, my God, thank God I didn't send that.
Yeah. Sobriety test.
Yeah, or you can have another one that won't let you send it until the next morning when you have to come. And then you look at it and think, very
good idea,
isn't it?
Yeah.
But then you, if you were pissed, you go, I won't use that one. I'll use a different one.
Well, that's good. Yeah. There is that one. Yeah, there are always ways around.
Just phone them up.
Yeah.
Go round.
Yeah, go round. Better. Shout outside the window.
Now you're in.
Lord. You've only just thrown me out.
Anyway,
what do you do that when you're pissed with a Ouija board? Contacting dead people, going, I'm glad you're dead. I hated you when you were alive. You were a pain in the arse. You made my life a misery. I turned into a steptoe there, Dave.
Do Ouija boards, are they outgoing as well? What tariff are you on?
You're going to think I'm making this up, but when I sit down, if I'm wearing a heavy cord, a jumbo cord, for example, one of the things that annoys me more than anything else is when I put my trousers on and sit down, sometimes it catches the long sock and takes it down to the and I sometimes will pull the sock up while I'm sitting there just to
nightmare.
Have that nice feeling of control of the sock reaching the knee.
You know what my dilemma is in that situation? Is what I often do is if I'm sitting on the toilet, is I often take my glasses off, right? Because I don't like wearing them.
For distance.
I don't need them. I'm sat there for a while, I don't need my glasses. Right. So I often take my glasses off, and the pants act like a little hammock for the glasses. It gets worse, because what if I put them in there? And then I might be sat there for some time, because my diet isn't the healthiest. I eat far more meat than I should. And then so I might sat there for 10 or 15 minutes. Good and then, Lord. When I stand up finished, I stand up to pull my trousers up, I forget about my glasses.
Oh, no!
And I go, oh, my glasses! And I've rammed my glasses deep into my under region.
Whoa.
And I clean this pair, I think.
Inside the mind of an arsonist. They're playing a psychological game in tonight's Ashes to Ashes next. The journey continues with Doctor Who tomorrow at 6:30 on BBC One, and the Daleks are back.